So in that DVD, in that instruction DVD, sorry, it's an online instructional DVD.
Yeah, it's a DVD. I keep saying DVD though.
Nobody has DVDs anymore.
Do they
not? It's like VHS. I don't know. Who has DVD? What, like Blu-ray?
I possess some DVDs. I mean, I've never watched them.
What do you use them for? Like a thing you put a drink on?
I mean, when in a pinch, yeah.
What's that even called?
Coaster. Yeah. My Matrix coaster.
the Matrix coaster. Zeros and ones. Okay. So in that instruction that people should get, I've been watching, I'm really enjoying.
Thank you.
I don't even know when it came out recently, right?
Yeah, like December or something like that.
Yeah. It's
part one. It was actually like ended up being like 18 hours long, and yeah. I was like, oh my god, we're gonna chop it in half. And when it comes together, the whole thing, I hope people will like it.
Yeah. Well, it's even part one is really good. It's actually, yeah. People on Reddit were really excited for part two as well.
Really.
And you also have a back.
Oh, the old one.
The old one that was really helpful to me to understand some very basic aspects of control from the back. Yeah, that was that clicked with me. There's very few instructionals. There's very few things I've watched that ever clicked with me. And that was definitely it. It taught me one thing. I don't know. You drop a lot of sort of bombs. You drop a lot of really interesting details. And it's funny that there's only specific things that really click. Like a lot of it rings true and you kind of take it in. And it's like, oh, that's interesting. Okay, yeah. But there's certain things that really click. And I remember when that first instruction will click with me is like the importance. I don't remember anymore like how you communicated it because I've now integrated. It's now mine. Ooh. You know what I mean? But it was more about you just describing upper body control and the importance of the upper body control from the back. Mm. And just like that there's certain like, you did describe different details on the grips and so on. And as I started trying it, I realized how important upper body control is versus like me, maybe as a blue belt or something. I thought like you have achieved victory when you got the two hooks in.
Mm-hmm.
And then I realized like, at least for me, that the hooks were not even for my body type, for my style, for the way I approach things, they were not even important at all.
They're supplemental for the most part. Yeah.
Yeah. So they were there for the points, but I can establish a huge amount of control. In fact, the hooks were you were talking about like illusion of choice. It almost made people panic a lot more when you were like fighting for or establishing that kind of control. They mm-hmm. weren't a lot less panicked when the hooks weren't involved.
Mm-hmm.
Even though they should be a lot more panicked. Anyway, I realized a lot of those kinds of cool. things, especially that had to do with judo, because so much of judo on the ground is centered around aggressive, efficient, very fast choking, different kinds of clock chokes and all that yep. kind of stuff.
What a brilliant thing that is only going to start to make its way into jiu-jitsu coming up, but like the judo style approach to like clock choking, triangling from the top of the turtle and stuff. So powerful.
Yeah. And there's something about judo that emphasizes, obviously, due to the rules, the urgency. Mm. So there, you only do techniques that go fast. And then the other thing is, which I guess jiu-jitsu emphasizes too, but judo really does, which is the transition. So like while the person's flying in the air is the easiest time. I mean, this is like Ryan Hall type of shit, which is like, why not put in your submissions or positional control while they're in the air? And they
well, if you could, why yeah. would you not, right? Yeah. And so like, I don't throw well. Well, learn how to throw yeah. and then do it.
And so you should think, I mean, in the transition, when they're flying is the easiest time to put in stuff. And that's when you think about chokes, as you're throwing, you should be thinking about the choke. And then everything becomes a lot easier.
You ever see Flavio Canto?
Yeah.
Yeah. Man, Brazilian judoka is yeah. so cool. Yeah. Like with stuff
correct.
Like that.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But that has to do with the first starting principle of like, stop thinking this as a two-phase game of standing and then ground. Start thinking about like the standing comes before and the ground comes after, but everything happens in the transition.
Well, and also you're attacking, what is the art of war? Like everyone's like, oh yeah, the art of war. Oh yes, yes, yes. And then they immediately throw it away and then fight like a freaking barbarian. But
yeah,
I mean, like, I'm serious. But you know, how many people quote stuff and then like, you know, it's like, the Family Guy joke where they're like, you know, quoting Jesus, and Jesus walks in. He's like, you know, I'm not talking about my work. What are you talking about? And anyway, basically, you know, like, what do you, like the art of war, you know, one of the things is like the only thing that you can be sure of being successful in attacking is something that's undefended.
Yeah.
We're like, well, yeah. But, you know, in a fight, though, they're defended. Well, are they? There's moments all the time where I'm borderline defenseless. And if you were to attack at that moment, if you could see it and then seize the moment, if you were capable of both, you should not only expect to be successful, you should be damn sure you're going to be successful. And more important than that, you'll be successful. And even if somehow not, you won't be countered. And I guess like that's the trick of almost all like conflict, right? It's like showing up when the other person's, you know, taking a nap. And then it's so funny, like we take like a protracted war. It's like, oh, it takes 5 years. And there's, you know, lulls, and there's a battle this month, but then there's a couple weeks and another battle. It's like, well, if you just shrink that down, it's the microcosm, macrocosm idea. That same thing, that whole war is taking place in 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 15 minutes. And there's moments of lulls of person effectively going for a snack, you know, being like, you know, in a horror movie, like, hey guys, I'm gonna go get a beer from the, from around the way. Like, I'm dead for sure. So anyway.
Is there, on this particular instructional, if you can convert it to words, you talk about finishing the submission. Is there some interesting insights that you find beautiful or profound about finishing the rear naked choke or just finishing the submissions from the back control? Is there some, like, you know, you talk about the squeeze and the crush and all these kinds of principles. Is there something about control, about the process of finishing that you find especially profound about this position?
Absolutely. The opposite of one profound truth can be another profound truth. So like,
did Jesus say that?
No, I don't. I actually was a guy on Tumblr. Okay. It was really, really cool. There was like a tree in the background. But anyway, but so let's say like, I'll use examples. Like first off, I saw someone finishing a 50-50 heel hook in the UFC 1 promo. It was like some chubby dude in a karate gi, like inside heel hook and another dude. And you go, huh. Well, I didn't know they were doing that back then, at least. And whether they were doing it all, how many times does someone do something and then that works? And then we go, okay, cool. Versus, hey, maybe we should do that all the time. So anyway, how long were we all taught to do the seatbelt the way we all do the seatbelt in jiu-jitsu? Like, long time. Why? Works. In fact, it works so well. And then the people who used it were so prolific that we went, well, solved that one. Good to go. All right. No more thinking. And then you go, imagine you were to, like the Merkel and Merkel flip, all those positions that were showing in the DVD, which is pretty much, or the, whatever the heck it is, I don't know, the digital VD. No, not VD. Don't want that. Digital video something. But basically recognizing that doing it on the wrong side is at least as effective. Doesn't mean that the other side wasn't good. There could be something that's the literal borderline opposite of that. And you go, huh. Well, that's something. Like, imagine, like, I would say almost all of these things, all the tactics and all the strategies. So I guess that was something that we came to, like, training in the gym, like, a year ago, maybe? I've been playing with since, and it's just, it's huge. I'm like, oh, wait, so let me get this straight. First off, I can use my strong side seatbelt, my right arm over the shoulder, any all the time. Well, that's really helpful because that's a lot better than my left. I can do both sides of my left, but if I had to bet my life on being able to finish it, I would want my right arm over. Huh. Everything that's a tactic or a strategy evolved from an idea. Like, capitalism's an idea. You know, anarchy is an idea, and then it becomes, well, what does that all mean? What are the consequences? What's the fallout of all this, right? So what if we start with jiu-jitsu, the idea of the guard, right? And we go, well, I mean, why do you use the guard? No other martial art really has developed the guard in the same way that jiu-jitsu has. Well, what is the guard? A guard's a defensive idea where you're kind of on your back to some extent or another, and you're using your legs as a wall between you and the other person, and the other guy represents danger. And you're like, yeah, that's a great idea. Is it? I mean, it clearly works, at least to a certain extent. But where do I want to put my legs when I want to get up? Not on the other dude. I'm trying to put them on things on the floor. If I want to generate a ton of power, what's the first thing I do with my feet? I anchor them to the floor. Drive for a punch, you name it. Move away, jump, dart, you name it. So does it mean that that's a terrible idea to be on your back? No, clearly it works. And clearly it, let me rephrase, has function. But what if the function that we're giving it and we're and the how much focus we're assigning to it is disproportionate to its effectiveness?
Yeah.
Maybe what if it's not a good idea? I'm not saying it's not a good idea, but what if it wasn't? That's a foundational idea of jiu-jitsu. And then how much, because no one questions that foundation, how much innovation is built on top of the idea? Well, of course I want to be, my being on my back is an okay position. So now they're innovating, but they're innovating within a closed system that they don't even, they think they're innovating in like in this open space of, oh my God, it could be anything. When in reality, it could be anything within this little set.
Yeah.
But you don't realize that you're in a set. You don't realize that you're in a box. There would be answers that would become so immediately apparent to you if you were willing to look outside of that, but you'll literally never even look over to your left because you don't even realize the left exists.
Do you think there's a lot of places in jiu-jitsu, whether it's back control or generally guards and all the different positions, where there's a lot of space, like a lot to be discovered by questioning the basic assumptions?
Yes,
maybe if you can give examples of like back control, like is there something you've discovered that's like—
Merkle versus seatbelt.
What's Merkle, what's seatbelt?
Seatbelt is right arm over the shoulder, left arm under the arm. I'm on the same side as my choking arm. Merkle is just, I do the same thing. I don't even adjust my hands. I walk myself over to the left side. I'm on the opposite side. It's actually a more powerful position.
Yeah, for people listening or for people who might not know, jiu-jitsu is a seatbelt is a control. We're talking about when one person is on the back of another person, which is a really dominant position in jiu-jitsu. Seatbelt is a, I guess, widely accepted way of holding like your arm.
Best practices almost.
Best practices, And it works so well. So it's a one arm over, one arm under, and there's a certain side you're supposed to be on when you're on the back. You know, everyone teaches there's a choking arm, that's the arm that's over, and your body's supposed to be on a certain side relative to that. And then Ryan is describing questioning these like basic assumptions about which side you're supposed to be on.
And let's say that's even just like a mid-level assumption. It's not even a first principles assumption, but
it's pretty close to
it's getting there. But let's just say for sake of argument, it goes a lot deeper. Maybe. I think most of the innovation that I see is not innovation. It's like basically changing the color of a car or polishing like the window a little bit. We're like, hey, you made it a little bit different. You made it a little bit better. It's like, oh man, what if I did the same guard and then grab the lapel? I'm not saying that's bad, but you're not fundamentally changing anything. I think most of the big seismic shifts that we see in almost anything come from, hey, that thing we thought was right was wrong, rather than not only is it right, it's even righter. And you're like, that's not wrong, that's not bad, but that's you're in. It's like, oh man, let's say for instance, I didn't make the triangle better, but let's say I made the triangle a little bit better than it was than it was taught. I mean, you can call it innovation. I don't know, man. It's not like the person that said, hey, have you guys ever heard of a triangle before and came up with that? We're like, that's on the list. You can do this thing to people? Are you kidding me? Can you imagine you invented the straight right hand? You'll be like one punch man. You can walk around and just lay low every single person you got into a fight with because it didn't even occur to them to hit you with their backhand. In a world full of jabbers, you throw your backhand, you're going to kill people. So basically—
Well, but by the way, I mean, just to pause on that, first of all, somebody did invent the triangle probably, right?
For sure.
It's not a trivial thing once you think—
No. How many of these giant things that we all go like, oh yeah, we all use that now. Can you imagine you have triangles and heel hooks and rear naked chokes and I don't have those?
Mm-hmm.
You're borderline. I mean, like that's why we all experience every single one of this, particularly those of us. I mean, when did you first start training, Lex?
12, 13 years. Well, let's not count wrestling, but 13 years ago with jiu-jitsu.
Right on. So let's say about that time where particularly it was still like kind of undergroundy.
Yeah.
You know, and you're like, hey, we all experienced being like a relative, like a mid-level white belt. And being able to easily beat up all our friends.
Yeah.
Because everyone wrestled all their buddies. And it was one of those ones where like, they don't have weapons to end the fight. Mm-hmm. You have weapons to end the fight. That's so, that's such a crazy, you know, asymmetric advantage that if you lose, it's on you now, man. Like you had the next time it's like, I've got this rifle and you have nothing. And I decide to put it on my back and then run over and try to karate chop. You're like, okay, next time, just make sure you use the rifle, bud. I'm like, I should do that. So
yeah, it's kind of fascinating to, everything you're describing is there's a fascinating tension between like whenever I show people for the first time what a triangle is, just like regular people, it's like they're discovering, it's like, oh, okay, that's interesting. I mean, MMA has changed that, but people haven't watched MMA. That's an interesting move. It doesn't make sense why that would be a choke. And they kind of quickly accept that that's a thing, and they accept the basics without questioning, wait a minute, what's actually being choked? How is it that a shoulder of a person can do the choking? Like, I'm not sure I fully questioned the fundamentals of all of that. Like,
I claim I have either.
What exactly is the blood supply that's being cut off? Like, what is the anatomy and the physiology of all of that?
Why does this work? And if you understood all that, what else can we do here?
Yeah, what else can we do here? That's the really important thing.
But if I'm an end user, which almost everyone is of almost anything, I'm serious, where I'm like, I think about stuff in my life, the only things I really think about are like martial arts and martial arts strategy and, like, I don't know, some other couple other things, but not much. And anything else in my life is borderline unexamined. And I like to think that if I put a lot of effort in something, I'd like to think that I could figure at least some things out about it. But I figured out almost nothing about anything in my life because I haven't even looked. And, you know, if you're an end user, what are you capable of versus you can literally alter the source code? You are Neo in the freaking Matrix if you can alter the code and I can't. And it's like, we think, like, ah, ha, ha, ha. But imagine you are a world-class anything, or even not even world-class, forget it. Like, a purple belt compared to a white belt or compared to a no belt might as well be John Jones or Marcelo Garcia. You're going to beat them up comparably bad. So it's that actually is a common thing where people can't tell the difference between levels. They're like, oh, man, I've trained with my black belt instructor. How much better could so-and-so be? And like, so much better, you're going to have a hard time wrapping your head around it. I remember when I first trained with Marcelo Garcia in 2007, I was a decent purple belt. And of course, he mollywopped me very gently. And then trained with him again in 2008. I was definitely better. I won the Gi and No-Gi Worlds that year at Purple Belt. So definitely, for the record, I'm definitely not a Jiu-Jitsu World Champion. I won it at Purple Belt, but like, that's not the same as winning at Black Belt. Tough accomplishment, but not in the same thing at all. But anyway, I was definitely better. He beat me up just the same. I'm like, okay. 2009. I was a lot better. Got a medal at ADCC that time. Won the trials, crushed everybody, like, no, just submitted everybody, like, bop, 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 bop. Trained with Marcelo Garcia. It was worse. And 2010, trained with Marcelo Garcia, same. So the idea was, I wouldn't be able to tell you the difference, and the outcome difference was the same in all of these rounds. I was significantly more experienced and more adept each time that this occurred. But it was like, how many number of times did this person submit you or pass your guard in the round? I'm like, I don't know, probably like, let's say five each one, because it's a brief period of time. And let's say it was 3-on-1, 6-on-1, I'm like, whatever, it's comparable. It's 6-1/2 dozen. Would I be able to easily tell the difference? No, I would just say, I know in concept that he's way better.
Yeah.
So much better. But there's plenty of other people that could have beaten me just as bad as Marcelo did when I was a purple belt or when I was a brown belt. Then maybe I would watch Marcelo walk through like they're borderline not there. So it's neat. Like, if you, that's back to kind of what I was talking about certain people beginning to really like peel back some of what's really special about the martial arts or any activity, I presume, is they get to a level of understanding and depth that they're playing with, like, the almost the reality of that thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm playing by rules that are not rules. I'm not even one of the, to use a Matrix analogy, I'm not even an agent, which is the best version of something playing by the rules.
Yes.
I'm like one of the regular people or one of the regular people in that got out of the Matrix. So I'm like, oh, I'm cool. But when I fight an agent, I lose. It's because we're both in the rules, but they just play them to the bone and I'm just here. Mm-hmm. Well, and then the agent encounters Neo and they can do nothing. You're like, why? Because operating outside of what the rules are, but not really what the rules are, what they perceive to be the rules are, clearly. So anyway, I guess that's kind of my point about Marcelo or certain other people that are doing things where you go, that doesn't even seem real. It doesn't seem real to me because I don't understand what's going on. And I guess if we can get down to base assumptions, like if we can constantly strip away, let's say we always thought that turning left was right, was correct, and it turns out that turning right was correct, you change your life.
Yeah. It's what is it? Socrates said, the unexamined life is not worth living. So you just basically have to rigorously just constantly examine every assumption over and over and over.
But doesn't that give your life meaning? To come back to the struggle, yeah. To come back to free will, to come back to what if we could strip all that away? All right, cool. All right, let me just stick the needle in my arm and that's that.
Yeah.